We also talk about goitre, hyperthyroidism, and pancreas. You can see that this is more of endocrine. See, the title is gastrointestinal, integumentary, endocrine. So all this while, the gastrointestinal has so many surgical conditions. And the, what's the name? Endocrine is just a few. And the integumentary is even worse. So the weight of this outline is more on the gastrointestinal than the endocrine and the because the surgical conditions, there are few. So for the thyroid gland, we know that it's located around in the front of the neck. And so if there's nothing wrong with it, you don't even notice that there's anything there. But there's a gland there we call the thyroid gland, which can become enlarged. So if it's just enlarged, we say goitre, and there are no issues. But you have one that can be maybe normal or just slightly enlarged, but it's producing plenty hormones. So we say hyperthyroidism, and that is a killer one. So you see people walking around with goitre, there's nothing wrong with them. Once they can talk and swallow, they are okay, it's fine. And when we have others that, apart from the way it is, it's not nice, okay. They also have a problem with the high thyroxine level. And because of that, they can't sleep, they are hyperactive, they are eating so much. Some of them, their eyes are even protruding, call it the exophthalmic goitre and all that. So that is why it comes into our domain as surgical carers to help them have a better quality of life. So you did anatomy and physiology in your diploma program. And please go and read your anatomy of the thyroid gland, the physiological processes, etc. So you can better explain issues about the thyroid gland to your patients. I always say read, read, read. Without reading, you are not a graduate. So there's no other way. So please, just accept that from now onwards, you are going to read as much as you can. I beg you. Because you have to own the knowledge. So if you read, then you can own it. Well, if you're not happy, I've said it already, so you just go and reach, I beg you. So, the incidence, when you have iodine deficiency, wherever you are prone to have goitre because the gland uses the iodine to produce the hormone. So, if you have iodine deficiency, the gland will be working more to extract the small amounts in the blood. So with time, it becomes bigger. Then you have the enlargement of the gland. You are supposed to eat food with iodated salt and all that. And if you are prone to any other thing related to thyroid, you have to take better care of yourself. And also, if you have an autoimmune disease like Graves' disease or Hashimoto's disease, you are at risk of getting goitre and other genetic factors. So we have what we call the endemic goitre, which is more because I live here in this environment that is iodine deficient. Almost every member of the community has something wrong with their thyroid gland. They also have non-toxic goitre. The cause is usually unknown and sometimes linked to genetic factors. We have toxic nodular goitre and then neoplastic. The neoplastic is a cancer of the thyroid gland. And then the nodular goitre is the one that you see like some round structures. It's not a smooth extension or growth. So if you have goitre, sometimes there's nothing wrong with you. You are just going up and down your normal life. But then as the size increases, then it becomes noticeable, some tight feeling in the neck. If it presses on the esophagus, you can't swallow well. If it presses on the voice box, your voice changes and all that. So once you have the problem and you come, looking at you, looking at your neck can tell us a lot. But then we have to go to the lab to see whether you have the toxic or the malignant or which type that you have. Once we go to the series of investigations and establish the diagnosis, we can give you some drugs to get the hormone level to come down if it's high, or we give you some drugs that can give you more iodine to help the thyroid gland to function well without working too much to enlarge further. So in addition to that, we now say that it's not everybody that we can operate. If you come and it's cancer of the gland and it's already, too late, it's already spread to the brain and other parts of the body, we can't do anything. The tumor is developed such that it has become very hard and fixed on the neck. We cannot help. So it's not everybody that we can operate. Depending on the type of goiter or enlargement we are talking about, we can help the patient to do a number of things. The first one is that if you come back from theater, you have to rest your voice because the voice box and the thyroid gland are very close. And we are not sure whether there was any damage in the theater. So after the surgery, we'll be assessing the voice, but then you have to rest your voice. So we have to explain to the family that after thyroid surgery, we are restricting you guys from, when you come, you don't talk to the patient too much. How are you? It's fine. Stay there a little and go. But if you engage the person in talking, you stress the person up. So that is important. Then the second thing is that after the surgery, because you are going to be propped up, you are going to go semi-powerless position. We want to secure your neck so that you don't stress the neck to affect the surgery. So sometimes they put sandbags around the neck to stabilize it. It means that the patient can bleed and the external, the dressing, you'll not see it, but the blood will be draining towards the patient's back. So you slip your fingers around the patient's neck to check that. And then the patient can also have internal bleeding. So when you have a goiter surgery or thyroid surgery, you observe for regular swallowing. You have not given the person any food. What is the person swallowing? So perhaps maybe there's some internal bleeding or something of that sort. So we make sure that all these things are done. Now, as one of the key postoperative requirements is to have a tracheostomy set ready at the bedside. In case of any emergency, the surgeon can quickly perform an emergency tracheostomy for the person so that they will not lose the patient. And always make sure that you have an additional pillow and suction equipment available for the patients. Pain control, we have mentioned it several times, so I don't want to belabor the point. Sometimes they put wound drains, small wound drains at the side of the wound, the neck when the surgery is done. You must make sure that it's patent and the dressing is done accordingly. And then we have neck exercises to make sure that the patient has adequate circulation in the neck area. So with that, we'll move on to the brief on hyperthyroidism specifically. Now, there's something unique about hyperthyroidism. In my explanation of the goiter, I mentioned issues about the high tyrosine level, okay, T4 and T3. But I want to highlight on the area that is important to me, which is the fact that after the surgery, a person can have what we call the thyroid storm. I want to highlight that. And also the fact that no surgeon should risk the patient's life for surgery if the person's thyroid level is not normal. So after a series of laboratory investigations, if it's established that a patient has attained the euthyroid state, then they send the person to the theater. Also know that the thyroid patients, the effect is on the metabolic rate. So people with high thyroid would have high metabolic rate. So whatever food you give to the patients is broken down very fast. So they are always hungry. And because of that, you have to give the person that privacy. So that when the person is overeating, in quotes, other people will not think otherwise. So a thyroid patient with high metabolic rate, you give the person that privacy that the person is that the person needs. And also because of their restlessness, they are always sweating and all that. So you make sure that you open their windows, there's some adequate ventilation where they are. And they are also very irritable. So you make sure that you don't mix them up with people who stress them up on the ward. So usually you see in most of the hospital, these patients are nursed in the side ward. So when the person comes and the surgery is done, we want to also, apart from the physical rest, let the person get mental rest. Because of the stress, the irritability and all that, after the surgery, mental rest is also very, very important. I've mentioned that the visitors must be restricted already. So we give them the prescribed drugs for a number of weeks to help them maintain a normal thyroid level before the surgery is done. Close to the thyroid gland is a parathyroid gland. So if we remove the thyroid gland partially or totally, and something also goes wrong, and then the parathyroid glands are also removed, the person will have what we call tetany. Remember tetany. So keep that and see whether you can read more to add to it. Then the voice can become hoarse because of the larynx close to the thyroid gland. You can have hoarseness of the voice as part of a thyroid surgery. Now, if the level of thyroid drops, so when they take the thyroid gland off, they are supposed to give you synthetic thyroid, okay? Now, something can happen and then that drug maybe is not enough or it's not available or something. You can end up getting hypothyroidism and then get mesedema, where you become very moody, depressed, inactive. You know, you are just there, boom. So you can remove one problem and cause the other. And one thing that I want to highlight, for which reason this is added, is thyroid crisis or thyrotoxic crisis, which is an alarming situation which may cause death very shortly after the operation. I'm hammering on this. In the first 6 to 12 hours after surgery, the patient may develop all the signs and symptoms of true goitre. The temperature can be high and very high, so hyperparesia. The pulse can be very fast. The patient will become restless. The patient will become delirious. And then, before you realize, the patient needs to go into coma. So after the coma, if nothing is done, then a patient can die. So when a patient goes for thyroid surgery, please, if you're on duty, between the first 12 hours, keep an eye on that patient. If you see any sign that the temperature is going up, the pulse, those of you who check the pulse for 15 seconds and multiply by 4, please, for a thyroid patient, don't do that. Because the tachycardia, restlessness, delirium, and then the patient goes into coma, know that you are going to lose that patient. So thyroid crisis is something that you watch out for when you have, what is it called, a thyroid surgery. So when you see the patient like that, what do you do as a nurse? The temperature is going to shoot up, so remove their clothing. Get water and stepping sponge the patient. Put the fan on. You can, there can be AC, put it on. Just to reduce the temperature as much as possible. And then sedate the patient with clopromazine. Propranolol is given to reduce the cardiac activity. Hydrocortisone, 100 milligram, depending on the age. And then you rehydrate the patient as well. Then you also call the doctor in. The two of you put your heads together to save that life. Then the pancreas, what do you do? Pancreas, if you say pancreatitis, is that inflammation of the pancreas? So is this a surgical condition? Yes, it's a surgical condition because the cause of the itis can be an obstruction. So if you don't remove the obstruction, then the itis, it will not go. So if it's just a plain infection, it's not a surgical problem. But if the pancreatitis inflammation is related to a surgical cause, then it becomes our problem. So I've given you enough information on this, but I want to highlight a few of the problems that a patient may have. The pancreas is in the abdomen, so abdominal pain will be there. The patient will not allow you to touch the place. So the pancreas is towards the right is the liver, so the left, when you are facing the diagram. So the patient will not want to touch that place. The patient will want to vomit, and the blood pressure will be falling. The patient can become confused with some respiratory distress. So you do a series of investigations, physical examination to establish the diagnosis. And then if you establish the diagnosis as a surgical diagnosis related to the inflammation, then you prepare the patient for surgery. And this course so far from session one up to now, we'll be talking about preoperative care, postoperative care, and we said so much about the abdominal related surgeries. So this is a similar one where you pass NG tube, you prepare the patient's vital signs, you shave the patient, you clean and cover, remove all things that you have to remove, including dentures and other things on the body, etc. And then you take the patient to the theater for the surgery to be done. What specific surgery can be done? We can do pancreaticojejunostomy. So this is anastomosis of joining the pancreatic duct to the jejunum. The first part, the normal part, is the duodenum. There's a problem there. So you take that part off. And instead of the duodenum, it's linked to the jejunum. Okay? For the whatever pancreatic juice to flow into the intestines for normal digestion to take place, for you to get the nutrients that you deserve. You have the other surgical procedures like pancreatodonectomy, where the head of the pancreas and the loop of the intestines that surrounds it are removed. Or you take the whole of the pancreas out. If that happens, then you have to give that person synthetic things to help in digestion of the food that we eat.